Lansingan, our CAS dean, to our former and revered professor, Dr. Senise, First Senise. He was also a former administrator of the university, friends, colleagues, and students. A very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome. It gives me a great pleasure to join you in this important occasion. That is the professorial chair lecture of one of our brilliant and ever hardworking faculty, Dr. Virginia Cuevas, who will talk on the ecological succession in areas covered by mine tailings in Mantayan, Benguet, Northern Luzon. To all our guests, thank you for graciously accepting the invitation to be with us this afternoon. I warmly welcome you to this professorial chair lecture, and I am sure you will not only learn from Dr. Cuevas, but you will also be enlightened by her talk. So sit and relax and prepare yourselves to be challenged, excited, and inspired. So on behalf of the Institute of Biological Sciences, again, welcome to everyone. It's really very heartwarming to see so many familiar faces around, and prepare your questions after. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Galis. I have the privilege of introducing our speaker for today. Our professorial chair lecturer for this afternoon is a multi-awarded UP scientist and professor of ecology at the Environmental Biology Division, IBS-CAS. Dr. Virginia Castillo Cuevas has numerous prestigious awards, including the following: Outstanding Young Scientist, Lingkod Bayan, Pantas, Rizal Pro Patria, 10 Outstanding Women in the Nation Service, NRCP Achievement, Metro Bank Outstanding Teacher, and more recently, the NAST U Greenwood Environmental Science Award, just to name a few. We all know her as the trichodermase, who invented the trichoderma microbial inoculant for use as biofertilizer, crop growth promoter, and biological control agent, as well as inventor of the rapid composting technology using trichoderma as fungus compost activator. Dr. Cuevas is a prolific and influential writer with numerous journal articles, policy papers, and instructional materials under her name. She champions the concept and practice of sustainable agriculture and is a much sought-after speaker on this topic. Her extension work and advocacy has brought her to many parts of the country. Most of all, Dr. Cuevas is a well-loved mentor and colleague. We fondly call her the fiercest EBD faculty, quote-unquote, because she is indeed fierce. In all her endeavors, she gives her utmost in all she does, and in return, she's given recognition for a job very well done. But perhaps the most precious reward she has gotten is the love of her co-workers, students, and most of all, her family. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Virginia C. Cuevas. At the request of our dean also, we would proceed with first with the awarding of the certificate. So may I call on Dr. Benino P. Lansigan, our Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, and to represent CIRCA, Dr. Cristeta Cortez.
Perhaps I should read the citation first. The Southeast Asian Regional Center for Graduate Study and Research in Agriculture awards this regional professorial chair to Virginia C. Cuevas of the Institute of Biological Sciences, College of Arts and Sciences, University of the Philippines, Los Baños, in recognition of her contribution to academic excellence in the field of plant and fungal ecology. Given this first day of October 2014 in Los Baños, Laguna, Philippines, signed by EOC Seguigue Jr., Director.
Are the major industries in Mangkayan. And
Magkayan has a long history of mining. Small-scale activities by the natives started even before the colonial period. But at that time, there was very low population density, and therefore the impact on the environment would be human. Large-scale mining in the area started during the American occupation, and there are two large companies, the Lepanto Consolidated Mining Company, started operation in 1936, and the Suyok Mines started operation in 1933. Now, small-scale mining by the natives remain operational even at this moment. The main products are copper and gold, and this is a target type of mining, not the open pit, because the gold or the vein of gold would be present at the very deep layers of the rocks. Now, rock waste production is very wasteful process. In 1975, mining companies considered a rock containing 0.03% copper as already an economic ore. This means that for every 3 grams of copper obtained, 997 kilograms of rocks gold waste. Now, I took these pictures from the small-scale mining in Suyok. What they do is that they melt the rocks into very fine particles shown here. And then they use water, turn this into slurry, and extrude it from the extraction site to the river system. So that in our Tomomac, this is the output of Professor Liliano, his co-worker. Notice that Mangkayan is very mountainous. And this Lepanto River, actually in Nangria, it is called Pumilias, but the locals would call this Lepanto River or Mangkayan River. Now, our study sites are abandoned tailing ponds. Notice that they are very close to the river system because they are using the river for extrusion of the mine waste. This is the active tailing pond which I am going to show you. And this site 3 would be an agricultural land that was covered or inundated by mine tailing in 1986. So, the area is very mountainous. So there are barangays that would be 1,300 meters, but the lowest barangay that's close now to Cervantes, Ilocos Sur, the river actually been joined together and formed the Abra and actually end up at the west Pacific Ocean. So whatever tailings, whatever contaminants that would be present at the river, it will be carried down to the coastal West Philippine Sea. Now, since Lepanto has been operating since 1936, there are already 4 abandoned tailing ponds, and we use tailing pond number 4 as our site 1. It was abandoned in 1989. It's 9 hectares total area, so we subdivided this into 3 sub-sites. There has been some interventions done, because topsoil was added. Actually, it was convenient for the company to do that. Because very close to this is a road, dirt road. That dirt road was widened and all the topsoil that was taken from the road was dumped into this. And that would provide some organic matter. And then in 2001, Typhoon Peria caused damage. There was a trash slide. Notice that there is a creek here, and there was garbage that covered the whole of the site. And currently, the area is used as a pasture area by the community. So this is a close-up. Notice, I took this picture in 2011. Notice that up to 2011, there are still scattered plastic bags, remnants of the trash slide. Now, I would like to emphasize that this is a hill covered by secondary forest. And this could have been possible sources of inoculum, seed inoculum, which could have reforested the site.
but notice that there are no seedlings of the trees, but mainly the vegetation, as you will see in a little while, would be all grasses. Now, our site 2 is TP3. It's called TP3. It is tailing path number 3. It's only 1.5 hectares in size, but the bigger one will be at the back. The reason why this is here in front is because in 1986, the dam of this tailing pond was breached. And so carrying these mine tailings forward, and actually it moved downward and covered and inundated agricultural lands. Now these are dirt roads going to the active tailing pond. Actually, this is the active tailing pond, which is called TP5. So, this is actually a dirt road again. This is where we pass through. The only treatment, or one of the treatments the Lepanto company does, is to add lime intermittently. So, not all the lime, but intermittently. And the reason for that is to neutralize the acid pH of the mine tailings. Now, why is lime added? Remember that the rocks will be present at the deeper layers of the earth. And there will be plenty of pyritic minerals, and that is iron sulfide. Now, once iron sulfide is exposed to air, it undergoes oxidation, and high concentration of hydrogen ions are released, and so you have also the liberation of iron. So basically, what is iron and sulfide? What is basically produces sulfuric acid, and actually pyrite is the commercial source of sulfuric acid. And we have monitored the river water from small scale mining with a treated effluent, and the pH is 1.8. And so that's one of the damages done by small scale mining, because they are not treating the tailing ponds with lime as large companies like Lepanto does. Now this is another view of the active tailing pond. It is basically twice the size of tailing pond number 4. It's about 20 hectares. So what we did was to get some samples of the fresh tailing. This fellow is my graduate student. He just finished his PhD just last May. What he did, so we get some samples to analyze the fresh mine tailing, and notice in this diagram that among the metals, heavy metals that we have analyzed, it's only copper that occurs in high concentration. And this is the reason why we have copper as the focus of our study. Now, along the periphery of the active tailing pond is this grass, Rhamnitis, and this is the subject matter of the study of Dr. Hipol. He found out that endophytic yeast is responsible for the ability of Rhamnitis to tolerate the toxic conditions of the tailing. Now notice that we started in 2011, and they have actually increased the height of the dam to about 20 meters. Notice that this is an open access. These are goats that are freely grazing in the area. Now, another, the company also do some cyanide detoxification. Lepanto is not using mercury. Mercury is being used by the small-scale miners. They are using cyanide to recover gold. So they have to detoxify cyanide by using metabisulfite. And they actually, I did not include one picture here. We have a picture which shows stacks of metabisulfite. And this is used to hydrolyze cyanide into carbonate and ammonia. And then they have a pump that would allow this water from the river to be coming out of this tunnel. So these are effluents. We have analyzed the copper content and iron content of this, but that will be covered in another paper, not today. So this is
Bailing Path number 3, our site number 2. Take note that it was abandoned in 1986, so it is 28 years from now. Notice that the vegetation is very scanty and there are creepers only. And notice also that it is surrounded by hills with secondary forest, which can be possible sources of seeds for regeneration. But notice that there are no seedlings of trees growing in here because of the very harsh environmental condition. These two ladies here, and actually, that's me, and that is Marx de los Angeles. Where is Marx? Also, a graduate student doing his MS, her MS along this line. Now, this is site number 3. This is an agricultural land. This is the Lipanto River, and this is 45 meters down. We actually come from the highway here and go down, passing through this cliff. That's the reason why I need some garden angels to carry me through or to bring me down from the upper elevation. Now, this was covered by mine tailings in 1986 because of this river. Take note that the tailing fan, the cross bridge is way up here, and this is all going down. So, with the mine tailings inundating this agricultural lands. So, this is our site. This is how vegetation is done. This is the transit line. Notice these are the dikes for the paddies. This was abandoned because no rice plants can grow in it here because of the toxic effect of copper. It has undergone natural regeneration and it is now used again as a pasture area by the community. This is site 3B, the upper paddy, which are still planted to rice with very low yield because again of high copper toxicity. Now, this is the vegetation, a diagram of how the vegetation analysis was done. This is actually the work of Donna and her family. Kasama niya lahat ng buong pamilya niya kung nagkagawa ng vegetation analysis. Okay, so 350 meter transit line would be laid parallel to each other at 10 meter interval, so a total of 30 meters. So total of 1,500 square meters were done for all the sites, 6 sites, even if the total area of the sites would be different, but the basis of comparison would be the same area. So in each of these quadrants, there will be 30 of these quadrants, the species would be identified, the cover, percent cover would be measured, and the frequency. And then importance value would be computed. Now, we did also soil sampling. One is February 2013 at the start of our project, and then another one in 2014 where we did more comprehensive analysis. So we took samples from different layers. Actually, these are layers within the rooting zone of the grasses and the forbs. So we have pH, available copper, organic matter texture, CC, and water holding capacity, but we did it only at the surface. Soil, that's 0 to 15 because of budgetary constraints. Then we subjected the data, especially for the soil, with statistic analysis, and these are the results. So, principal component analysis or agent analysis of the correlation matrix showed that soil site characteristic and available copper would explain 42% of the variation. And then the second component would be the layer and pH that would have significant coefficients. So the combination of this and copper content would be modified or strengthened by pH and variation in the different layers. Thus, we concluded, based on this analysis, that it is the soil environment in each site which is the determinant factor for the plant community present in each site. So, the soil characteristics, pH, texture, organic matter, layer variation, plus the available toxic levels of copper would influence water holding capacity and cation exchange capacity. So that the soil environment in each site would affect nutrient and soil moisture availability. Take note, plus the toxic effect effects of copper. Take note that in here, we have comparison of the 2013 data and 2014 data. So the 2013 data, the highest copper was found in site 2, but in 2014 data, the 220 ppm in site 2 is already a little lower. The highest will be found in site 3A, that's the pasture land, from 165, 185, it went up to 342, but all the others will have decreased available copper. Now, the pH. In 2013, the pH of site 2 is 4. But in 2014, the pH is already 3. In other words, even for site 1 and site 3, the pH went down. But take note that site 2 would always have the more severe environment. Organic matter content, notice in 2013 data, it has very minimal organic matter, 0.03. Here in 2014, it has climbed up to 0.4, but all the others would also have increased organic matter. Now, based on the statistic, there is significant higher organic matter at the surface soil, which is just logical. Now, CEC and water holding capacity. They note that site 2 would also have the lowest water holding capacity followed by site 1C. The highest would be here at site 1A. Then they have their site 3A and site 3B. Now, in my analysis, water holding capacity is highly correlated with soil organic matter, which is just right, because soil organic matter would provide application which would increase water holding capacity. However, there is no correlation between CEC and organic matter. In most literature, they would say that CEC is highly correlated with organic matter, but in this case, it's not. Probably because of the very high copper, which interferes with the cation exchange capacity. So that, based on this analysis, I concluded that site development or improvement of the soil environment proceeded in this manner. Site 2 is having the harsh or most severe environment. Site 3 would have the most improved or advanced. And site 1 would be the transition between site 1 and 3. And changes in the soil environment would mean changes in plant species composition. And that these areas are actually undergoing primary ecological succession. We learn in basic ecology, and that's what we are teaching in our undergrad course, that primary succession happens in areas where there has been no organism that has occupied the area. But in this case, before it became a tailing pond, there are already vegetation growing. But why do I say, and why do ecologists say, that it's still primary succession? It's simply because there is no soil structure whatsoever in the tailing pan. What has happened is just physical weathering. Remember, the rocks were just milled. They were ground into fine particles. There have been no chemical weathering that has happened, no soil formation, so that the area is actually undergoing primary ecological succession. And so these are the vegetation that were surveyed in 2013 dry and wet season. This is site 2, as I mentioned, the most severe environment. Notice that the vegetation cover is only 10%. It increased to 24% during the wet season. And there are very few species that are able to tolerate the condition. Digitaria sanguinalis was the dominant species. Then you have Paspalum conjugatum during the dry, and then the scrupulatum, Paspalum scrupulatum during the wet season. And then they have the minor species. I'd like you to pay attention to this Mimosa pudica. It's a legume, but it is
is already present even at the early stages, but as a minor disease. Now, take note of symptoms. Wrong spellings. Cyanodont, dactylon, is only a minor species here in site 2. But if we move to site 1, which has much improved soil condition, Cyanodont dactylon is the dominant species in all the three sites, followed by Paspalum conjugatum, Dentopeia, etc. Notice that there will be more species present here. I did not have a complete list, but a total of about 44 species would be monitored in this site 1. Now, this is site 3A. We did not have a sapling in the rice paddy because it was planted to rice at that time. But notice that sources I have the Cyanodont dactylon and Paspalum conjugatum, which are the dominant species. Notice Mimosa pudica would be present here. And then this area would have already seedlings, shrubs, and small trees. Cassia occidentalis, Cassia thoria, Tora, Gimelina, and then Mimosa indusa. Although they are still minor species. And as you see in this picture, this is the river. Notice that it's very close, but the area is along the river path. You have shrubs and it is being utilized as a pasture area. The shrubs would be absent in sites 1 and 2. And this is the reason why I concluded that this is more advanced, also because it has much higher organic matter content. But it revegetated through the natural grasses in 1986. No intervention from the company. No compensation to the farmers whose productivity was very, very much lowered because of the presence of mine tailings. Now, this is the data from March. This is, we analyzed the fruit protein and fruit fiber of Paspalum and Cyanodont, because these are the dominant species which are eaten by the cattle and the horses in the area. Now, this is a comparison of the total number of species in the different sites. As I mentioned, in site 1 alone, we monitored 44 species. Most highest would be in site 1A, and then we have site 3A, etc. Now, 2014 sampling. Drastically, the number of species from 44 was reduced to only about 8 in site 1. But the dominant species remained the same. Cyanodont, dactylon, Paspalum, Cubea. What were lacking here are the minor species. The same thing is true with site 2, but this time, Paspalum conjugatum became the dominant, Scrupulatum the next dominant. Digitalia sanguinalis, which was dominant in 2013, is now reduced as a minor species. Take note that the site has a pH of 3 in this 2014 sampling. Again, the total number of species is reduced to only 10. The same thing is true for site 3. Reduced number of species to only 15, whereas before it's 25. But the dominant species remain the same. And then also you have the presence of the small trees, Cassia occidentalis, and you have already Amaranthus romulana, odorata, etc. Now, the question is, why was there a reduction in number of species? I look at the meteorological data, and we know that in 2014, we have the minor or slight El Niño phenomenon. There was no rain in January, February 2014, and if you compare the amount of rain in the area, 2013, January to May, and January to May, lower by 2,000 millimeters. So it means that there is moisture stress with the sandy substratum coupled with grazing resulted in much of the minor species being displaced. And whatever resources that are available to the minor species were utilized by the dominants. And that's the reason why they increased their importance value. But the beauty of this is that we are now sure that the dominant species
are able to cope with the stresses of the environment, and that's the reason why they remain dominant. They are adapted to the environmental conditions of the area. Now, my hypothesis on the succession based on soil environment is supported by the dendrograph of cluster analysis. This is by statistics. Notice that this is 1, 2, 3, this is site 1A, B, C. They cluster together because they have very high similarity. Notice that site 2 is the most different. 5 and 6 would be site 3A and site 3B. Now, this would be the similarity level. What is very clear is that site 2 has very minimal similarity with site 3. And site 1 and site 3 would have a much higher similarity level as compared to 2 and 3A. So it means that we are correct in saying that site 2 would be the primary stage in succession and 3A would be the more advanced. So, these are now the characteristics of the dominant species. Paspalum conjugatum, this is carabao grass, is a pioneer and persistent species and very tolerant of grazing. Notice that at pH 3 and copper content of around 160, the importance value is about 50. Then at pH at 342 ppm copper and pH of 5, it has an importance value of close to 40. So it is very tolerant of acid pH, very tolerant of low soil fertility, and tolerant of copper. And it's a very strong competitor. Now, Cyanodontactylon, its importance is decreased by very low pH. Notice that at pH 4, its importance value is very low. But it obtains optimum growth at pH 5 to 6 and organic matter of 0.6 to 2.3. And it is also very tolerant of grazing. Now, these are the first group of species that occupy site 2. Vegetaria sanguinalis, tolerant of pH 4 and copper of 220. Paspalum scrupulatum, the same. So they're tolerant of infertile soil, low pH, available copper, but they are not strong competitors. They are easily displaced when the soil environment improves. They are easily displaced by other plants at a pH greater than 5, and if the soil organic matter increases to greater than 0.6, but they can tolerate up to 160 ppm or 220 ppm copper. Now, Mimosa pudica, I keep on pointing out Mimosa pudica because it has a very important role to in reclamation of areas covered with mine tailing. It has very high tolerance to soil pH and to available copper. Notice that it is present even at pH 3 and becoming dominant at pH 5.6 and very tolerant of copper up to 340 ppm copper. So, it's a legume species and that has been monitored on all sites. First, as a minor species, becoming dominant at high copper concentration. It is adapted to acid pH and infertile soil. And it has very significant contribution to soil fertility because it's a nitrogen fixer. And the composition of its biomass would increase available nitrogen in the soil. And it is very tolerant of grazing. So, our conclusion. Soil environment in the site is a driving force that creates the shift in plant species composition. Site 3 has the most harsh soil environment because the company did not do any intervention. It represents the pioneering stage in ecological succession. It has very minimal cover even after 28 years. Site 1 has much improved soil physical and chemical properties, principally because topsoil was added, and then there is garbage that was accidentally incorporated, and this garbage would increase organic matter content, so there is acceleration of soil development properties, so you have faster plant colonization. And site 3 is an agricultural land, more advanced stage of ecological succession. It has the highest organic matter content, probably brought about by the regular inundation of the river. So every rainy season, the river will bring copper as well as organic matter content because it's almost at the same level as the river bank. And the greatest improvement in soil fertility, you have also the presence of shrubs and tree saplings. But it has the higher available soil copper. And I read in the literature that manure of animal grazers, a very high amount of soluble organic compounds, which will form complexes with copper, which renders copper more bioavailable. And that would be more dangerous because more available copper would mean that there is a greater chance for the copper to enter the food chain. Now, my recommendations, as I have shown you in the map before, you have the Philippines and Southeast Asian countries would have mine contaminated areas. So it's a common problem in the region. And the lessons learned from this study, I would say, can serve as guideline for ecologically sound and environmental safe rehabilitation of areas covered by mine tailing. So my first recommendation is to pay particular attention to the soil environment because it's the driving force that causes silt in species composition. And the environment must be matched with the plant species adapted to harsh conditions. Ecological succession takes centuries to complete. If there is no human intervention, abandoned tailing ponds, as you have seen in site 2, will continuously pollute the environment through wind erosion. Take note, it is sandy substratum, and then there will be downward leaching polluting the river system. And large tracts of land are covered by these abandoned tailing ponds and they remain idle. And we know with high population pressure, land is a very precious commodity. So we have phytoremediation as a very good technology or means of reclaiming abandoned tailing ponds. Plants are the main contributors to soil organic matter buildup, because organic matter is stabilized and reestablished nutrient cycling, and these are very important components for ecosystem development. Now, I would recommend that the low-cost soil amendment would be compost from biodegradable waste, such as those from the market. I have a series of papers showing that compost greater than 50% organic matter would significantly improve soil physical and chemical properties as well as such as pH, CEC and water holding capacity. And we have shown that it can reduce available copper from greater than 200 ppm to less than normal level of 30 ppm. Now, I have already shown you that there is the process like in 2001 for ATP for a site 1, byways accelerated succession. And this is a paper that is coming out in Philippine Science Letters. And we have shown that rhizostrobe compost with 50% OM, we were able to reduce the amount of available copper from 281 to 25 ppm in rice paddy. So inoculation, this is my thought, would be more successful if there will be higher amount of organic matter, because the inoculated mycorrhizae nitrogen fixers would proliferate faster and higher rate of infection if
organic matter will be present in the soil, and improvement of the rhizosphere would lead to better nutrient cycling. The pioneer plants should be grasses because they have fiber loose system that would bind the loose antiparticles, and the grasses would lessen wind erosion because sandy is easily blown by the winds, which would cause air pollution of heavy metals. Grazing animals should be banned from feeding an area. Copper or heavy metals present in the plant tissues are detrimental to animal health, and this will be proven by the thesis of March. Animal manures deposited in the area may cause the heavy metals to become more mobile and bioavailable. Increased bioavailability increases heavy metal hazards via leaching and the probability of the heavy metal entering the food web. Now, I'd like to acknowledge Dr. Benigno for doing all the statistical analysis, and I would like to thank my mentor in ecology, Dr. Sanise. Thank you, sir, for inspiring me to do ecological studies, and I'm very proud to say that we have trained several plant ecologists. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cuevas. I now call on Dr. Lupo to moderate the open forum part of this.
Congratulations, Dr. Cuevas, for the nice presentation. My concern is the trash slide. Where did it come from? And because it reminds me of our trash here in Jamboree. We do not want to have that kind of disaster in the future.
As I mentioned, Bantayan is very, very mountainous. So there is municipal dumping ground in the area above the tailing pan. So I'm trying to look for the municipal hall, the population of this area. It's about 1,000 meters above sea level. This is about 800 meters. So the dumping ground is located somewhere here. And look at this river. So when there was Typhoon Feria with the garbage heavily soaked with rain and you know, steep slope would cause the garbage to topple downward. And that is, Baguio recently had also that 2011 happened also in Baguio. It's just like the Payatas crash slide in 2000.
I think Dora would like to add something.
I would like to add to what Ma'am Cuevas has just said. Actually, my husband is in charge of the solid waste management in Benguet. And Mangkayan actually is one of the problematic municipality as far as solid waste disposal is concerned. So the waste actually are just accumulated at the cliff. So whenever the rain comes, the strong rain would usually bring down the waste to the lower part of the Mangkayan. So it's an open pit depository. Yung mga cliff na mga mountains is an open pit depository of solid waste or anything. No, all waste actually are actually thrown on the cliffs. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Sir Marga,
kita
lang
po kayo.
Si Silvino America. Is this okay? I am a retired cytologist. Has this results been presented to forum that would include people from the DNR and the Bureau of Mines so that they will know what really is the hazard of mining and then possibility of rehabilitation if they have money to support you?
This is the first time that we made public our results. So, probably later, when his because as a professor chair lecturer, this will be published as a monograph, and probably we can come out with a science article summarizing our results. So probably after that, we must publish first and make public this paper.
Sir, I just could not resist. Because I have asked G already early this morning. I went to her lab and I asked all the questions that I want to ask. But just to highlight, I know this, that mining firms are required by law to rehabilitate. The only problem is that they are not doing it and nobody is saying that. So this baseline, this scientific study could provide the information that will help them do the rehabilitation more effectively. So that's the importance of scientific studies like this. But I told you that you may have all the scientific facts before you, and yet now action still take place. Because it's more than scientific information. You need other things to come in, like the political will, the stakeholders themselves, especially the local community, being able to have the capacity to respond. And you have to have all these ingredients together before the action, and a significant and sustainable action can take place. Remember, I said sustainable, huh? You may have an action, but it may not be sustainable. So the findings actually that we have had already is that scientific evidence is necessary but not sufficient. So please remember that. For us scientists, we may have the romantic idea that if we have the information, that's enough. They will act. No. The experience that we have, and even in other places, that it takes more than that. So that's the challenge, because if you look at it as a wider kind of necessary action, there has to be corresponding actions from other elements. But this is an important start. So if I say this, don't be discouraged as a scientist, because sooner or later people will be looking for the information, maybe not now. For example, in assisted natural regeneration, and it's described in a book that came out, I don't know, 2 years ago, Ecology, Environment, and Sustainable Development. This assisted natural regeneration, that was an information that was generated by my PhD thesis in 1970s. And how long did it take the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, even the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, to pick it up and say, yes, we will use this? It took about almost 3 decades. Huh? So okay, mawala ng pag-asa. Tayo mga scientist. Kasi sooner or later, hahanapin nila yun eh. Somebody will be looking for it.
Dr. Cardenas, first thing, Dr. Hicks. Dr. Cardenas, I'm so glad to be here, Dr. Seguse, and Mac Cuevas were my teachers 7 when ecology was still starting. My question is, sometimes it's community-based management which will work, and then the trash that fell on that accidentally helped the organic matter thing, and then we have a colleague from Makaya said that, you know, I'm just wondering, can't we just have those heat areas as the proper trash area of the community? It cannot overflow and with proper restrictions. I'm just wondering, because if it's taking decades, can community do the work somehow? That would work ways.
Actually, I am negotiating, together with the mayor of Mantayan, I am negotiating with the PANCO to do some rehabilitation work. And my focus is, number one, management of the solid waste. Precisely on rehabilitating and demonstrating to the community that this is an important resource that if managed properly, provide amendments to the damaged lands. But as I was discussing with Dr. Saizer this morning, it seems that the EMB car is the lawyer of the Banco. I don't know. I hope you interpret it correctly. Putting all the hindrances, all questions to mentioned by Dr. Saizen, this is a very complex problem because it involves money. And asking Lipanto to really admit their damages in the environment that they have done is a very, very big thing for them to swallow. So it, as mentioned by Dr. Saizen, it will be the political will and the community action, and it has to be sustained. And I am not a native of Mangkaya. That's the problem. I guess, although I'm retiring this year, probably I will have more time, but in going to Mangkaya, I spent 2 days just travel time. One day going there and one day coming back. So if I have to work on convincing the community, convincing Lipanto, I might have to stay there a longer period of time. Pag-reglami mga ang dalawang anak na nandito dito. Looking after my health, because I'm growing older. But we will do something about that, because Dr. Cirilo Lagman, unfortunately, was unable to come, was at the forefront. He's a SOIS major, he's a native of Mangkayan, and he is from PSU. So together with the mayor, probably we can do something about it. But it's a long, hard battle to fight for.
E for our next, may follow-up okay, sir. Si Dr. Lee po sana muna, sir. Then we can do your follow-up. Sir Lee?
Na number opportunity ng IBS. Ang concern ako doon ay yung mga camping at baka na natuon. Sana ayun ako na ipagbawal yung pagkamayang move. Kaya lang, minsan kahit na sinasabing bawal ay dahil mahilig mag-alaga ang mga taga-Cordillera at ang mga Ilocano na naroon mga Ilocano na doon at mahilig kumain ng papain at sumana ay kahit nakalagay na bawat ay ipapasul pa rin doon, magkakaroon pa kayo, nagkaroon na ba ng monitoring, kasama na ba ito sa thesis ni Marge? Yung halimbawa, pagkuha ng, di ko naman, nakukumuha na ba ng blood sample halimbawa, no? At nakita na ba yung copper levels nila? And then, yun ang sinabi mo kasi kanina sa lecture mo ay baka makapasok sa food chain. Pero sa aking pananaw, na kung nakita mo naman doon, nakapasok na yun. Lalo na kung nakapasok na
yun. Marx, would you like to explain the results of your thesis? But as pointed out by Dr. Saize early this morning, we need more thorough experimentation so that it will be able to stand in the court of law.
Nagkakaroon ng konti. Kasi mahalaga din yung data. Kasi kung ipagbabawal natin at wala tayong papakita sa mga tao na ganito yun, ganito na ang level ng sa tugupan ng kambing at baka, eh, hindi magpumunta sa tao lalo na. Yung kung ipapakita natin sa mga tao, sasakayan sila na okay, bawal na.
Marge, take it away.
Nag-i-abstain po talaga si Marge.
Sir, so the animal part of my thesis was as the third objective. So we extracted blood from the cows. That was based on the the blood that we extracted is subjected to different chemical tests. We have hematological tests, so RBC, red blood cell count, and white blood cell count. And aside from that, tinignan din namin yung kidney and liver function of the cows. From where the blood was taken, tapos copper levels were also measured. So according to the results that that I got from Biotech, copper levels were extremely high, kasi the normal range of copper within the bovine animals are 0.6 to 1.5. However, the results that I got, 4 to 7 parts per million, yung copper set ko. So basically, mataas talaga siya. Tapos, in terms of the red blood cells, as we all know, parang copper, it somehow aids in the production of red blood cells. But in high amounts, it would lead to the parang destruction of these blood cells. So it would also explain kung bakit may hemolytic crisis na nagaganap sa mga cows. And in effect, ang kanyang physical manifestation sa ating mga cows ay lethargic siya, so meaning lazy. Hindi ganun kalustrous ang coat ng kanyang mga cows, and then payak yung mga cows doon sa makayan. So basically, hindi talaga siya dapat kinakain ng kumain.
Kaya pala po pala matamlay ang mga baka sa loob. Okay, Sir Marka, yung inyong follow-up question.
You may or may not answer this one. Wala kasi akong alam sa mining. Ang alam ko lang yan talaga, very hazardous. In the first place, kung wala akong alam sa mining, talaga na mag strip mining, you physically destroy the environment. Okay, ang tanong ko ay ganunin. Ano ba ang cost sharing o benefit sharing na nakukuha sa isang mine? Whether it is financial sharing sa community, o sa gobyerno, o sa pulisya, o may taxes lang ba yan? I don't know about this benefit sharing.
I have very vague knowledge of this, but I heard from Mayor Luspian of Mangkayan. He was complaining that all the taxes are going to Makati. Because the main office of Lipato is in Makati. So, Lipato is paying taxes to Makati and not to Mangkayan. Yes! And all the damages starting from the tunnel waste disposal are suffered the most community suffering from. So, there is some lopsidedness even on the very low regulated mining. That's why mining is a very, the civil society of this side would say, stop all mining activities, the government will decide, we cannot stop mining because it is contributing to GNP, etc., etc. So, there is so much work to be done.
May I just add, lahat po ng mga mining companies ay hindi o Benguet or other areas na nandun yung mga minas ang nag-gain sa mga profits from the mines because the offices of these mining companies are all in Makati, so all taxes from the mining activities are all paid in Makati. So, yung bumabalik lang po doon yung share ng municipal communities, which is a very below, very very low percentage. Yung Lipanto Mining Company, actually, wala naman po siyang ginagawa. Well, I'm very brave to say na wala pong ginagawa sa pag-rehab ng mga nasira niyang kalikasan. It's good for the Philex Mines kasi meron at least effort na ginagawa ngayon. Nagtumutulong sila sa pag-replant ng mga trees na sa mga bundok na kanilang mga sinira at nagpubuhay sila ng mga seedlings. But for Lipanto, wala pong, well, kinocontribute sa pag-rehab ng ating environment. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So, last na lang po before we close the...
Sorry. Sorry. I'm Tolentino, College of Forestry and Natural Resources. Congratulations, Dr. Jean Cuevas, for a very interesting professorial lecture. Quick lang doon sa waste. Under RA 900 the Ecological Solid Waste Act of the Philippines, dapat ay sanitary landfill na po lahat sa buong Pilipinas. Bawal na po ang open pit. In fact, UPLD po ay pinasarado po ang ating open pit dahil bawal na po yun. So, meron po tayong open pit doon, pwede pong kasuhan sa Ombudsman yung Mayor po. Maganda po yung sinabi ni Dr. Sahisi kanina about trying to nilaman po yung scientific information. We really have to come up with very good monitoring evaluation tools. And this is one example of an information we're providing to our society. Meron po kasi talagang Mining Rehabilitation Fund, MRF ang tawag po sa under the Mining Act, I think 1995, the Philippines, ang RA niya. But dito po, required po talaga mag-rehabilitate yung mining companies. In fairness, there are good companies that are doing rehabilitation. I think mentioned like FedEx, you know, where we know of other mining companies who are doing their job well. Pero kung ito pong Lipanto ay hindi po ginagawa ng tama yung kanyang trabaho, I think we should expose the information. Meron po kami ginagawa kasi ng project, a quick tool used in the field. It's based on landscape ecology, and maybe sure precise, you know, landscape function analysis developed by CSIRO, which monitors stability, infiltration, and nutrient capital. But anyway, tama po sabi ni Dr. Saise, we should really push for a better monitoring evaluation, and yung pong information ay may provide dati po sa leaders natin. Pero gusto ko rin pong i-raise is, hindi lamang po kasi big companies ang dapat natin tingnan. We should also look at, kasi minention din ni Dr. Cuevas kanina, small mining groups or small scale mining. Ang dami po nun, pag multiply po natin yung lalo sa Mountain Province and Benguet, ay parang large-scale mining na rin po sila, at wala pong monitoring na ginagawa or rehabilitation required katulad po ng big mining companies. Kaya sa totoo lang po, very compounded po ang ating problema sa mine rehabilitation and restoration of mine-affected sites. But I do believe that we have a group of people here sa UPLB po who are dedicated for preserving environment. So we could really form groups and be an advocate advocate for restoring ito po mine affected sites. Maraming salamat.
Last na lang daw po, may request lang po yung birthday celebrant for tomorrow before our discussion. Pagbigyan lang po natin si Sir Dinulet and then we'll have our discussion.
Birthday din mo ni Bob G sa Flower Seeds. Baka hindi lang ako yung hihinga ng blog. Maganda po yung recommendation kanina na vital education. I just hope na pag isasagawa yun, kasi kalimitan pag may vital education, ang namomonitor lamang ay yung halaman. Eh, ang nakikita kong panganib doon, basta kasi may halaman, natural na merong pupunta na herbivores, from micro-herbivores hanggang sa mas malalaking ibon na kumakain doon sa herbivores. At posible kasi papasok na doon pa lamang sa maliliit na insekto na kumain sa kanila, nakakainin ng mga ibon o ng iyong pang wildlife. Ang pasok doon ay may epekto yun sa buhay o iba sa pangingitlog o sa maintaining ng wildlife na mas malalaking. Kaya dapat maging, kung imo-monitor yung vital remediation ay holistic.
Sa totoo lang, we just scratched the surface. At sana marami tayong makonvincing ecology majors because these are very good. This is from the, as I have been doing from my undergrad and graduate students. At aking graduate students na nagtatrabaho dito ay lima. Dalawang MS, dalawang PhD, at isang bagong karirin root, si Jerry Maya. And so we have very good materials. So we must continuously encourage graduate students to work
on this. Okay, thank you very much for all your questions. Should you have additional questions, you can approach Dr. Webas personally and raise your questions. So we'll now give the mic to our discussant for this afternoon.
Dr. Dun, I'm sure all very good old, it's past time, so everyone would agree with me if I say that Dr. Cuevas has clearly presented the dynamic interaction of soil and vegetation in a natural attenuation process of mine waste copper contaminated lands. In fact, I think there is no room for additional discussions anymore because she did a very detailed discussion even with the soil effect of soil properties, but I may not be able to get out of this room without saying something, so let me just do a very quick recap. She also highlighted that soil properties, particularly texture, water holding capacity, pH,
pH, organic matter content, CEC and copper content can control the plant species involved in a succession in a particular area. And according to her, soil environment is the driving force that causes shift in species composition of the plant community. This is what we call ecological succession. And using the principal component analysis, they were able to show that site and copper concentration can explain 40% of all variations. Based on this, I can say that soil copper concentration therefore plays a major role in determining the plant species composition in those areas. The next controlling factor that was mentioned was soil pH. Soil pH is also an important factor because it can also determine the solubility, mobility, and bioavailability of nutrients as well as heavy metals. Now let's revisit the sites and see how soil environment has influenced the dominant species that were found in those areas. Site 2 was considered to be that site with very severe soil environment. It had the lowest pH, lowest OM, lowest water holding capacity, lowest CSP, lowest levels of P and K. In other words, this site was considered to be water and nutrient stressed with even toxic levels of copper. So only those plants tolerant of these harsh conditions were able to survive. And these are the pioneers. And in this area, they were able to record 20 plant species. But now the presence of 17 minor species, which include two legumes and a nitrogen scavenger, is expected to improve the soil conditions such as soil structure due to the input of organic matter from plants and the increase of nitrogen content. Site 1 appears to be in a transition stage between sites 2 and 3, and they were able to record 44 species, the presence of 44 species. Now, the contribution of these grazing animals to the increase in soil OM has been significant because for a very small area of 0.27 hectares, they were able to count 100 heads of mixed types of animals, including cattle, horses, and goats. Site 3 had a much improved soil condition than sites 1 and 2. And so they were able to record 25 species, but they were able to observe 75% vegetation cover. The results obtained from this study can be used as guidelines for the rehabilitation of tailing ponds and areas affected by mine tailings. Revegetation has been identified as the first step towards reclamation. However, we have seen that copper mine tailings are difficult to revegetate due to nutrient deficiencies, high levels of acidity, and potential copper toxicities. Natural attenuation would be slow, and so we need human intervention. There are various ameliorative practices that can be done, like application of lime to correct acidity, application of inorganic fertilizers, so we have a stable plant community that is established, application of organic fertilizers to increase the organic matter content of the soil, and which would also increase the CEC and increase the nutrient availability, and application of microbial inoculants to improve nutrient availability in the area. Phytoremediation is seen as a cost-effective and environment-friendly technique. However, selection of appropriate adapted species would be critical. From the results of this study, we can see that Paspalum conjugatum, or carabao grass, appears to tolerate a wide range of soil pH. It has been a dominant species in site 2, which is a very acidic site, so it's a acid-loving plant. But it is also a codominant species in sites 1 and 3, where pH range is about 6 to 6.8. So Paspalum conjugatum, or commonly known as carabao grass, would be a strong competitor. It is tolerant to high concentrations of soil copper, as it is dominant in sites 3 and 2. It is also tolerant to
low fertility level. So considering phytoregulation, this is one option, the use of Paspalum polyglottum. Grasses also have fibrous root system, which can be a source of organic matter in soils. Now, another reclamation approach would be to combine the use of soil amendments, which will aim to improve the physical and chemical nature of the site, and the use of adaptive species. So it's a combination of using ameliorants and adaptive species. Whatever reclamation technique, process we choose, it should be economically sound and cost effective. And most of all, it should be site specific. At this point, I would like to thank Dr. Cuevas, Mamichi, for also including the soil aspect in her studies. I'm a soil scientist, and I'm very much amazed at the soil data that she has gathered. I'm sure the results will also be a valuable contribution, not only to plant ecology, but also to soil science. In case you need more working hands, you can call on us and we will help you with the analysis of soil parameters.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bern Sanchez, for our discussion this afternoon. I would like to thank everyone for coming and participating in this healthy discussion and exchange of ideas. I hope the students, there are many here, the students in the audience have been inspired to pursue careers in ecology, environmental science, and allied fields, because these are very important and highly relevant areas that need immediate attention. For the faculty, researchers, scientists, and other professionals in the audience, I hope Mam Ji's lecture has rekindled in us the passion to work and care for our environment. Once again, thank you all for coming, and congratulations, Dr. Cuevas, for your fierce environmental activism. I believe do you have words before we close the program?
Thank you very much, especially my students, whom I coerced as part of my fierceness to attend the seminar with the promise of bonus points if they submit papers. Reaction to the paper. Thank you very much for coming, and please take your snacks.